true words. And then it goes on before Caiaphas and the other events. And this is at the crucifixion. They were all astonished because it was unusual for those crucified to die so quickly. It goes on here, Joseph of Arimathea. After a little while, he noticed that Emmanuel was only half dead, but he told no one. And then Joseph of Arimathea quickly got permission from Pilate to have the body taken down and put into his own tomb. And Joseph of Arimathea sought out Emmanuel's friends from India, went back with them to the tomb. They went in through a secret second entrance unknown to the henchmen, to the soldiers, nursed him for 3 days and three nights so that he was soon in better health again, and his strength was restored. And it goes on, that, and this is about the guards. Pilate said to them, take my soldiers as guardians, go and watch the tomb as well as you can. But they did not know the secret of the grave, namely that it had two exits and entrances, so that Emmanuel's helpers could, without being seen, go to him to apply healing salves and herbs so that on the third day he was again strong enough to walk. And, oh yeah, we go, it's time for the next tray here, but we're almost at the end here. There's a wonderful passage that is concerning Gabriel, concerning the biological father, and that the passage in the Talmud of Emmanuel is about how that at the tomb that night, a beam ship came down. There was a thundering sound, and the beam ship came and landed. A celestial sun came out, and it says in the Talmud of Emmanuel, the soldiers got out of his way because they feared him. It's like he was, perhaps his clothing was perhaps glowing or shining, and he just walked toward the big stone in the front, and the soldiers got out of his way quickly. And then the passage is there. It's like something Mark Bean would do. It gives the account how that this celestial son, he pointed his hands at the soldiers one after another, and lightning bolts came out and zapped them and knocked them down, and they were paralyzed. And this is a great thunder. A guardian angel came out of the light. His appearance was like lightning. His garment was white as snow. Went to the tomb. The soldiers got out of his way because they feared him. Hey, I'm going over here. It's like he wasn't afraid about anything. And the soldiers got out of his way. He lifted his hand from which came bright lightning that hit the soldiers one after the other. And they fell to the ground and did not stir for a long time. That could be, you know, Mark Bean in Las Vegas. He does the thing where he can rig up the actors and so on with wires, and they've got big electric whoop charger things. And he, you know, zap people like a lightning bolt thing, 25 or 30 feet. So anyway, maybe it was something like that. Maybe the lightning was purely produced by spiritual power. Either way, it's okay with me. And then let's see. Oh, anyway, there's more of these things about Mary Magdalene, and the guardian angel said, don't touch me because I am of a kind different than you, and my garment is a protection against this world. If you touch me, you will die and be consumed by fire. And he goes on. This is just the conclusion here that Emmanuel with his mother Mary, this was after recuperating at a safe house in Damascus, recuperating for 2 years after the crucifixion. And then with his mother Mary, his brother Thomas, and his disciple Judas Iscariot, Emmanuel traveled to northern India. And then they went through many hardships. In today's West Pakistan, high up in the north, the last branches of the western Himalayas, his mother became very sick and died when Emmanuel was about 38 years old. And it goes on, Emmanuel continued. When Emmanuel was about 45 years old, he married a young and pretty woman who bore him numerous children. Settled down with the normal head of a family, today's Srinagar, Kashmir, India, undertook numerous trips and continued preaching his new doctrine, died at the age of between 110 and 115 of natural causes and was buried in Srinagar. Judas Iscariot died at the age of about 90, was buried near Srinagar. Joseph, Emmanuel's firstborn son, continued writing his father's story and left India after Emmanuel's death. After a 3 years journey, he returned to the land of his father, to Israel, and lived in Jerusalem until his death. From India, he took along the original scrolls, that's the Talmud of Emmanuel scrolls, and hid them in the burial cave in which Emmanuel had lain, that's the tomb of Joseph of Arimathea. He considered that place the safest. And it goes on, these scrolls were found there, 36 chapters of which are rendered here in translation, and then that's by Billy Meyer. And so that's how the Talmud of Emmanuel came to us. So, up here, Mount Kailas in western Tibet. I think that I ought to finish in about 2 minutes or so. That I have more material. There's a lot of material. I've got another tray of slides and so on, but I think I better finish here. And just to show you briefly, here's another map of, this is one path that Jesus may have taken. This route, incidentally, called the Silk Road, that is the most famous and most ancient trade route in the world, the Silk Road. And there were thousands of travelers, and have been and still are, travelers who travel this Silk Road like this in Afghanistan, with camels, horses, and on foot. Nomads were among the earliest traders on the Silk Road. These in modern Afghanistan continue the old tradition. So that's the Silk Road. This is one of the, it's from 1924. This is one of those wonderful paintings by Nicholas Roerich. I've got some of those in Elizabeth Clare Prophet's book. There's quite a few of them reproduced. And if you want to see those, wonderful, wonderful paintings. This is how after the crucifixion that Emmanuel may have taken that route. Oh yes, this is real interesting. This is the Pleiadians had this 2,000-year-old drawing of Emmanuel, and I've also heard that Semyase herself may have drawn this. And then take a look at this one. This is Billy. Billy had this drawn in connection with a police artist in Switzerland. That is the, you might need to swallow a little bit to fathom it, but in 1957, when Ascot was Billy's teacher, that Ascot took Billy traveling backwards in time. They went to 32 AD to the Garden of Gethsemane, and Billy got to meet Emmanuel and talk with him for a couple of hours or so at the Garden of Gethsemane. And but his hair was a reddish, reddish brown color. His eyes were like a steel gray or bluish. And he was about around 6 feet tall, about 170 pounds. And then the last thing here, this is from a cave. And you notice, see the nose there? This is from a cave in Illinois. This is an ancient American magazine, Christ in America, ? This is in a cave. Do you see how the nose looks, the look of the face? This is carved in stone in that cave in Illinois. And then this, and you look at the nose in this one there. You see it? Okay. So, but anyway, that's the conclusion. And would anyone like to have? We can have a question and answer time for 5 minutes. Would we like to do that? Okay. That's the conclusion. Thank you very much, everyone. Thank you, Bob.
Guys, we're going to try to keep this break here to just a couple of minutes because we want to get Jim up here as soon as we can. And this break is going to be only about as long as it's going to take to recue the tapes. So 5 minutes maybe, and then we're going to continue rolling. Going to continue rolling.